In the previous video, we were talking about transformers, this architecture that uses attention to give unprecedentedly good performance on sort of language modeling tasks and some other tasks as well, but we're looking at language modeling. And that was in preparation to make a video about GPT-2, which is this very giant language model that has been, that was recently not released, actually, by OpenAI. The way that they generated the data set for this is pretty cool. To get enough text, they went to Reddit and they pulled every website that is linked to from Reddit.
Do we have any idea of how many that is?
Lots. It wasn't literally every, it was everything that had more than 3 comma, I think, or maybe more than 2 comma, something like that. Like anything that had somebody had thought to post to Reddit and at least 2 or 3 people had thought was good enough to upvote, they scraped the text from that. It's pretty much just a transformer. It's not that the architecture is not especially novel. They haven't done any like amazing new discovery. But what they realized was transformers, it seems like the more data you give them, the better they do. And the bigger you make them, the better they do. And everything that we built up until this point is clearly not, like we haven't hit the limits of what this can do. They thought, well, we think we're probably bottlenecked on data and maybe network size. So what happens if we like turn that to 11? What happens if we just give this all the data and make a really big one? It makes sense to talk about the acronym, right? So it's a generative pre-trained transformer. So generative, same as generative adversarial network, it generates outputs, it generates samples, you know. Pre-trained is this thing, I was talking about all of the different things you can use a language model for. Right, you can do translation, you can try and resolve ambiguities, you can do summarization, you can answer questions, you can use the probabilities for augmenting other systems. So yeah, there's a bunch of different benchmarks for these different tasks that you might want your language model to do. And this is what we talked about in the GridWorlds video, of having these like standardized problems with standardized metrics and standardized data sets, so that if you're comparing two different methods, you know that you're actually comparing apples to apples. And this is like very important. It gives you numbers on these things. It's often quite difficult, like you're generating samples of text and it's like, how plausible is this text? How realistic does it look? Like, how do you put a number on that? It's kind of difficult. So there's all of these standardized metrics. And the thing that people came to realize, which actually, I mean, I say that as though it's like some amazing discovery. It's fairly obvious. If you train your system in a, like an unsupervised way on a large corpus of just general English text, and then you take that and train that with the data from this benchmark or the data from that benchmark, you can like fine tune it. So you start with something which has like a decent understanding of how English works more or less. And then you say, now I'm gonna give you these samples for like question answering, or I'm gonna build a system using that to go for this benchmark. So it's pre-trained. You start with something that's like a general purpose language model, and then you, from that, fine-tune it to whichever actual benchmark or problem you're trying to solve. And this can give you better performance than just starting from nothing and training to each of the benchmarks from scratch. Makes sense. And so the point of the GPT-2 paper, the thing that makes it cool is, they said, okay, if we make a really huge one, what if we don't fine-tune it at all? What if we just make a giant model and then just try and run it on the benchmarks without messing with it, without showing it any of the specialized data for that benchmark, just the raw general purpose language model? How does that perform? And it turns out surprisingly well. So this is a very, very large data set for text. It's about 40 gigabytes, which actually doesn't sound like very much, but like for text.
Of text, that's insane.
Right. Somebody said that this was the size of Google's entire index of the internet in 98. So like, it's a lot of text. And they trained it on that, and they ended up with a 1.5 billion parameter model. BERT, which is like a previous state-of-the-art system, was 345 million. This is 1.5 billion, so they've just made the thing much, much bigger. And it performs really well. Some of the samples that they published quite captured the public imagination, you could say. And now that we've talked a little about the problems that neural networks, or any language model really, has with long-term dependencies, we can now realize just how impressive these samples are. Because when you look at them if you look at them uninitiated, you're like, yeah, that's pretty realistic. It seems to like make sense and it's cool. But when you look at it knowing how language models work, it's like very impressive, the coherence and the consistency and the long-range dependencies. So we can look at this one that got everybody's attention, the unicorns one, right? So they prompted it with, in a shocking finding, scientists discovered a herd of unicorns living in a remote, previously unexplored valley in the Andes Mountains. Even more surprising to the researchers was the fact that the unicorns spoke perfect English.
Well, hello!
And from there, you then say, you go to your language model, GPT-2, and you say, given that we started with this, what's the next word? And what's the word after that? And so on. So it goes on. The scientists named the population after their distinctive horn, Ovid's unicorn. These four-horned silver-white unicorns were previously unknown to science. We do have a clue here as a human being. Unicorn, four-horned, doesn't quite make sense. But nonetheless, we're going okay. Now, after almost two centuries, the mystery of what sparked this odd phenomenon is finally solved. Dr. Would that be Jorge? Jorge Perez? J-O-R-G-E? An evolutionary biologist from the University of La Paz. This is impressive because we've mentioned the Andes Mountains in our prompt. And so now it's saying, okay, this is clearly, you know, in a shocking finding, this is a science press release news article. It's seen enough of those because it has every single one that was ever linked to from Reddit, right? So it knows how these go. It knows, okay, third paragraph, this is when we talk about the scientist. We interview the scientist, right? Okay. First word of the scientist paragraph, doctor, obviously, right? Because this is now we're in the name of the scientist. What name are we going to give? It needs to be a name, conditioning on the fact that we have the Andes Mountains. So we need to get, we're in South America. The name probably should be Spanish or maybe Portuguese. So we get Dr. Perez here. And then evolutionary biologist makes sense because we're talking about animals. From the University of La Paz. Again, this is the first sentence, like when you have that first clause that introduces the scientist, you always say where they're from. So we say from the University of, and then university names tend to be the name of a city. What's a city? Well, we have the Andes Mountains, so we're gonna, you know, Bolivia. La Paz, perfect. And the thing that's cool about this is, it's remembered all of these things that were quite a long time ago, several sentences ago. Well, it hasn't remembered them, it's paid attention to them across that distance, which is impressive. But also, this is encoding a bunch of understanding, a bunch of information about the real world, right? All it was given, all it knows is statistical relationships between words. But the way that it comes out to us is that it knows where the Andes Mountains are, what kind of names people in that area have, what the cities are, what the universities are, all of those facts about the real world. Because in order to have a really good language model, it turns out you have to kind of implicitly encode information about the world because we use language to talk about the world, and knowing what's likely to come next requires actual real world understanding. And that's something that we see in some of the other things that they got it to do. You can see the real world understanding coming through. Let's keep going. The University of La Paz and several companions were exploring the Andes Mountains when they found a small valley with no other animals or humans. Perez, see, we're hanging on to him, yep, we're referring to him again, but now we've changed it to be just the surname because that's the format that people use in news articles. Perez noticed that the valley had what appeared to be a natural fountain surrounded by two peaks of rock and silver snow. Presently others then ventured further into the valley. Around about here in our article, we should have a quote from the scientist, right? Quote, by the time we reached the top of one peak, the water looked blue with some crystals on top. And we're talking about this fountain, I guess, this natural fountain. We're referring back to the previous sentence. Like, everything is relying on and contingent on earlier parts of the text. While examining, I've skipped a paragraph. While examining these bizarre creatures, the scientists discovered that the creatures also spoke some fairly regular English. Now, when I read that, I was like, okay, this is now unusually good because that's the second sentence of the lead, right? We're six paragraphs in and it knows about this point, I've covered the first sentence of this initial paragraph. Now it's time to talk about this second sentence of the lead. Even more surprising to the researchers was the fact that they spoke English. And it completely ignored the speaking English part until it got to the part of the news article where that comes in. You've gone six whole paragraphs. The idea of accurately remembering that the unicorns speak perfect English is like, that's very impressive to me. And then it goes into, it gets a little bit unhinged. Starts talking about, it's likely that the only way of knowing for sure if unicorns are indeed the descendants of a lost alien race is through DNA.
That's Reddit, right?
Well, it's not actually stuff on Reddit, it's stuff linked to from Reddit. But yeah, this is news articles, man. They seem to be able to communicate in English quite well, which I believe is a sign of evolution, or at least a change in social organization, said the scientist.
That's his evolutionary biology though, right?
Right. Yeah, we know he's an evolutionary biologist. So the coherence of this text is really dependent on its ability to condition what it's generating on things that it's generated a long time ago. So it can generate really nice news articles, and it can generate all kinds of text, anything that is sufficiently well represented in the original data set. So that's GPT-2. It's a really unusually powerful and like versatile language model that can do all of these different natural language processing tasks without actually being trained specifically on those tasks. That's why it's impressive. It's not that it's a brand new architecture or a brand new approach or whatever. It's just when you make these things really huge and give them tremendously large amounts of data, the results are really impressive in the original data set. So it will write you Lord of the Rings fan fiction. It will write you cake recipes. There's all kinds of examples of different samples. Here's a recipe for some kind of peppermint chocolate cake. And it's got a bunch of different...